Is investment something that's always been on your mind, but you don't quite know how to get started on that journey? We are here to set you on the right course. Welcome to My Cashflow Academy's Investor's Corner with your host, Athena Paquette Cornier. We are all about getting out of the rat race through creating positive passive income through real estate investing. Here you'll hear from regular people just like you and the professionals who support us towards greater wealth. Learn before you earn. Move from analysis to action and find the right path to attaining the success that you've always dreamed of for yourself. Now, here's your host, Athena.
So welcome everyone to Women in Investing. This is, used to be a live in-person monthly meeting for women who want to get out of the rat race, to hear from other women who have gotten out of the rat race or are close, and then also the businesses that support us in growing our wealth. So Women in Investing now for the last year has been online, but we're having actually way more fun in some ways because we're hearing from people all across the country like Carisa. And actually we've had a couple of people join us from other countries. So it's become more of a global networking group and super fun. So tonight I have Carisa Dahl, and she is an investor herself along with her husband, and she's here because she, I asked her to tell her story about how she went from negative cash flow in, like we were talking, one beach community being the South Bay here, to a job opportunity came up. And so they had to move. And so her husband came to Torrance Unified School District's class that we teach just to figure out where they're at and how do they make that transition with their assets and their family. So that was a big change for your entire family and for definitely, you know, selling assets that you own with other people. I mean, you had a lot of challenges there. So I'm glad you came to talk to us about all this, Carisa. And so why don't we just kind of start by introducing who you are, where you grew up, if you grew up with like a Trump family where you grew up with the real estate spoon in your mouth, or kind of where did you come from?
Torrance.
Ironically. And you're in Melbourne, or you're in, what do they call that? What do they call Space Coast? I knew, I was like, Cape, I couldn't remember. Okay.
I mean,
I love that.
I had never heard of Melbourne until we had to move to here. And, you know, a lot of people in California don't know about it. They think I moved to Australia.
Yeah. That's funny. You're brave, but maybe not that brave, huh? That's funny. So yeah. What so you grew up in Torrance, and
yeah, I grew up in Torrance, just
and what did you study? Were you like a mathematician or an economist? I mean, what
was always more in the liberal arts. I did not like math. Although I married an engineer, so I must like it sort of.
That's funny.
Yeah, I married an engineer, and I'm currently, two of my boys are engineer majors. So
interesting. Analytical. So would you call yourself analytical then, maybe? Or
no, but I was a music major. I have a degree in piano performance, both a bachelor's and a master's from Cal State Fullerton. I went to El Camino.
Wow.
I'm a South Bay girl. But I guess music is very similar in analyzing and math and structure and all of that.
Structure.
Without all the numbers, which is the good part of it. Like, yeah. I'm not a numbers girl.
That's interesting. So we'll hear some more about that. So what was your first investment for? How did you fall into real estate? Did you have a light bulb go up one day and say, oh, I want to own real estate?
Well, it's interesting. My sister, it's a convoluted story, but all of my stories are convoluted. I don't know how I end up in convoluted stories, but I do. So my sister had a friend who was a very good friend. We're all actually still good friends. But her long, long time boyfriend was into real estate. Well, he was murdered. And
oh my God.
Yeah, I told you I have convoluted stories. So all of his, and he had no will or anything. So, but he had all of these properties. So my sister, well, not so much me, because it's not really my thing, but I was there watching the whole thing, had to go, and his little empire was basically just house of cards down. But that was my first
exposure,
like, here's this normal guy, and he owns like how many apartment buildings and houses. And of course they didn't make anything, because it all just went into probation, and it went into
the probate court. And your
probate
sister,
court, and
so your sister wasn't married to him. Did he have any?
No, this is my sister's friend.
Oh, okay.
Her longtime boyfriend. So of course she didn't have, he had left some of the stuff to, you know, it's all a very close family, and they were all very, very close friends, and for many years. So, you know, I knew him, of course. And, but anyway, so that was my like, there's this normal guy with a normal job who owns all of this real estate.
And did you wonder, how did he do it? Like, you never got a chance to ask him.
No, I didn't. But I mean, I knew, because my sister was helping do all of the financials with her friend.
Oh.
And, you know, he was borrowing money from one to buy another, borrowing money from that one to buy another one. And it would have worked if, you know, that didn't happen.
Yeah, right. Oh, that's sad.
It was very sad, but it was like my first, like, oh my gosh, what did this guy has, like, this empire? What is this?
Yeah.
You know, that was my first thought. Well, what if, you know, so that was our first thought about it. So my sister and I actually, we both got married, and we decided we were going to buy a house together, because it's obviously very expensive in the South Bay to purchase your first home.
Mm.
And my husband was not so into the idea of buying real estate. Mm. So this was kind of like, well, we could purchase this duplex in Lawndale, and then they can live in one side and we'll live in the other.
Uh-huh.
So it kind
okay,
of
that's good. Horrible, that's what we teach.
First, you know, finagling. Yeah. So a few years, you know, we have kids and we didn't want them to go to Lawndale schools. So we said, well, let's borrow money, like this guy. We'll borrow money from this, and we'll buy this other property, and we'll keep this one as like an investment.
Yeah. So, and did you, your sister and both couples moved out, or just one?
Both couples moved out into another duplex, which was an illegal duplex.
Okay.
I also dabble in a lot of illegal real estate. I guess like it wasn't really.
Well, we'll say gray area, not illegal.
Gray area. No. So, I guess it's not really illegal if you both agree, and you know, we only had one mailbox, and you know, with one water heater, but it was essentially a duplex. Mm-hmm. She lived upstairs, we lived downstairs, so we did that for a long time. And the other thing we also did was we bought a condo in Chicago. Mm. And I did, when our firstborn was born, because we thought, well, I don't know if I want to do the 529 programs, because what if they don't go to college?
Yeah.
What do you do? Or what if, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, well, wouldn't it be better just to buy real estate, and then that would fund their college?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So we thought, well, Chicago, because that's where he's from. And we figured, well, every time we go visit his family, we'll just visit the property and write up the trip.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which we hardly ever did.
Right. But it's good in theory, right?
It's good in theory. It didn't really work out very well. But.
Yeah, I'm thinking your husband must have been kind of surprised when he sat in my class and heard some of the things you guys did, but things that you and your sister did intuitively. He's hearing it presented like, this is the way to build wealth, right? So that must have been a little bit eye-opening, not shocking, but sort of like, oh, you know, because you guys did it by your intuition, right? Did you read any books to guide you? Like, did you?
No, and we should have. And I wish we'd taken your class long before, because because that dumb, dumb duplex. We had a property manager, but he wasn't keeping the rents up.
All right.
So when it came time to sell it, we had to sell far below market value, because we didn't know that when you sell a duplex, it's based on what the rent is, not right. what.
Yeah, I always say the property is worth what it pays you, right? The property's worth what it cash flows like that, right?
So but what that current cash flow is, not what the potential is.
Right.
Right. What is it performing at? And it was kind of below because we'd had tenants in there for a long time and right. they were scrounging, and we knew if they moved out, it would be a lot of work because they were filthy and they had animals when they weren't supposed to. And, you know, we're like, we just don't want to have to go money into it. It's just easier to keep the rent low. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. You're frozen.
Yeah, we can hear you.
So we didn't keep that rent up, which we should have, because we lost a lot of money when we sold it.
Right.
I mean, we didn't lose it. We made a lot of money, but we could have made a lot more.
Right.
So that was, we learned everything the hard way. That's a good lesson.
Yeah. Very good lesson.
And then,
time frame, can you just give us an idea, like what amount of years we've covered here?
Oh, okay.
In a space of 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, what?
We bought the Lawndale duplex, must have been 20 years ago.
Okay.
It was right when my firstborn was born. The first year, it was like 19 years ago, and about 4 or 5 years after that is when we bought the other duplex in Torrance. Okay.
And the condo was when?
Probably near the same time as that we bought
the second duplex?
Second duplex.
Okay. And you picked Chicago because that's a little out there, right? You just to pick an out of state, but that's because you had
family. We couldn't afford anything in LA.
Right.
That's an investment property. You need so much down. And, you know, we're a single income family. You know, I wasn't working much. I was teaching piano, but not right. a lot. And you need a lot of money down. So
in Los Angeles, you know, in California in general. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. In general.
Even back then it was a lot of money, right?
Yes. Even back then it was a lot of money. So
way back in the day.
And we were like, well, it's cheaper in Chicago and we're going to be back there and we can write off our trips. And we did.
Yeah. Makes sense. Right.
Like twice. Well, it didn't pan out very well, but because then 2008 hit.
Oh gosh. So this was before 2008, right?
Yeah, before 2008. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And just as a general rule, when there's a downturn, condos get hit harder than single family homes, right? So,
and rent too.
In general.
They had that whole thing where if you couldn't get kicked out of your home and you couldn't be evicted. And so rents went way down because people weren't moving. They just stayed for free in their houses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Home. Yes.
So,
good deal if you can get it, right?
Yeah. But not so good if you're the landlord.
Right.
And just struggling because that condo was basically, when we bought it, it was like $300 cash flow.
Mm.
But soon after, it was negative.
Mm.
We couldn't get tenants.
Mm.
So that was a negative cash flow. And then, of course, the property value just plummeted.
Mm. How much did you pay and how much did it go down to? Do you remember?
Glenn wrote this all out for me, Mr. Numbers Guy.
Great. We love him.
I do. I don't. Yes, he's. Let's see. Where is it? Again. Okay, so we bought it for $168, and we sold it for. We bought it in 2004 for $168, and we sold it in 2016 for $150.
Okay, and you had to hold on to it because it took the dip. You had to wait for it to come back up. And sometimes you have to do that, right? And did the cash flow improve?
Never.
It never recovered from that. That's interesting. It's interesting how a lot of markets, you know, like here in Southern California, we don't see that kind of crazy ride with the rents, but there are some towns where economics can really affect things, like Detroit, right?
Well, and also, you know, governments are very corrupt. So what was happening in Chicago in Cook County, where our condo was they were assessing your property and you have to pay, not like in California, you have to pay, your taxes go up every year. So mm-hmm. your rent goes up, your taxes go up. And what they
Wait, hold. So your rental income goes up and they get more money? Is Glenn trying to chip in his thoughts or?
No. My boys just got home from climbing. I'm like, and they were yelling. So I'm like,
Okay. Okay. So is that what you're saying? The income goes up and they...
No, not their rental income. They just say your property value goes up, even if it doesn't. They just say it does, and they raise your taxes.
Okay. So
they raise your taxes. Well, the HOA got tired of that, paying more taxes. So what did they do? They hired an expensive lawyer and charged everybody for the expensive lawyer to get the taxes.
Gosh. Okay. Well, that was, so when you're, so just for people to know, so when your tax bill is in the HOA, that's usually what they call a co-op or a share building. It's not like our condos here where you have individual ownership and therefore you have individual tax bills, right? So every city works differently on how they're taxed.
Right.
County, yeah.
Oh, and also you have to have a business license every single year to rent your condo. Mm-hmm. Which is basically another tax because it's just a fee paid to the city. So it's just every which way they want to tax you, they do.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, so they did lower our tax bill, but it didn't benefit us because we had to pay the lawyer
to
do it.
Right, a special assessment. So they call that special assessment. Each owner had to chip in to cover this expense. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay. And then can we backtrack a little bit just so people kind of get inspired by this? So when you bought
your first... Not very inspiring so far, is it?
Well, I promise you would talk about the good, bad, and ugly. So I'm trying to...
It's murder and intrigue.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Murder, negative cash flow, bootlegging it. Okay. So Carissa's story of investing. Okay. So when you
bought the interesting part.
So when you bought the first duplex, what was the price and how much down payment did you put? Just so we can get an idea of the finances and how much you invested.
The Lawndale, thank my husband.
Yes.
Bought it for, I think, somewhere in the mid twos.
Okay.
And I probably just put like 5% down or something on it.
Right. Yeah, leverage, right? So two couples can easily share a $12,000, $15,000 down payment, right?
Right.
Okay, awesome. And then when you refinanced, how much cash out did you take out of that asset 5 years later? Did you get 100?
Whatever it required to buy the next place. I don't know.
Okay, you don't remember.
The next place we bought for in 2004, so it was pretty high market then.
Mm-hmm.
People were buying stuff sight unseen.
Mm-hmm.
But we bought this house that, of course, another death. The guy died in the house and nobody wanted the house because he had just died in the house and nobody spoke English and the realtor didn't speak English and they were hoarders. You couldn't even get to some of the rooms and there was fleas. It was terrible.
Yeah.
So it was one of those properties. So like, well,
so you're like, yoo-hoo!
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay, cool.
So we bought that for $660.
Okay, so you must have at least put 10% down. So what amazes me and what I'm trying to drive home, like you can buy an asset with leverage. You can put, let's just call it 15 grand to buy this first asset. And then you get enough cash out to buy another asset that's even more. You got more money out of the asset than you ever put into it, right?
Right. Totally. And we bought houses that were just... You know, the Hollandale duplex, it was actually being rented on, it was Section 8.
Mm.
And I mean, I had several times where SWAT team came to the door looking for the people who lived there.
Who used to live there? Oh, okay.
Yeah. A few times they came because they just had the wrong
address. The records, right, yeah.
Yeah, so you know, the door knocks and there's 20 cops out. I'm like, hey.
Yeah, right. Yeah, spooky.
So that was the kind of property it was. It was pretty bad. And so it was a lot of sweat equity, too. A lot of sweat equity. Both properties that we bought were properties that you couldn't just move into. In fact, both of our families lived in one. We cleaned two bedrooms and the kitchen in one bathroom and lived in one because we couldn't.
So you could work on the other one and then move this family in there.
It was so filthy and terrible. We couldn't actually move into it.
right. Well, so, but that's how you find the value deals. If someone else fixed it all up, you'd be paying the retail price for that, right?
Exactly.
So you wanted the wholesale price. I get it. You know,
sweat equity. We did a lot of sweat equity. And also on the second property we did was a lot of sweat equity.
Mm-hmm.
It was a lot of work.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then after that second duplex, did you ever buy a house for yourself to live in, or did you live?
We just lived together.
Okay. I'm just, clarifying. Okay. And the second duplex, was that in Lawndale too, or was that in Torrance?
That was in Torrance.
Okay. Got it. Cause I thought you lived in Torrance when when you were leaving.
Yeah.
Okay. So fast forward now, So your husband gets this job offer and you go, okay. And as I recall, he was moving already and you were here taking care of the family business. So had you ever lived in Florida or visited Florida even?
I went once.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I hadn't.
So you really didn't know what you were had in store for you.
They sent us on a week trip. His company did. So that
on the scouting, do you really want to move? Do you want to accept the package sort of trip?
Right.
Okay. Right.
So we did that, but we had gone once before to see his dad when his dad was in Florida for the winter. Mm-hmm. He's a snowbird.
So okay.
And once before to the west coast of Florida, but I mean, it was just a few days and.
Mm-hmm. Well, a tourist versus can I live here? Those are two different mindsets, right? Yeah.
Totally different mindsets. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's very. Okay. Very different in Florida.
And so, I think Glenn came to the class in 2016 and that's kind of what,
that's when they moved. Yeah. That's the,
So he came to the class and was already, as I recall, he was already moving there in a couple of months.
The process of moving. Well, he was working there a lot. So he was kind of going back and forth for a while.
Got it. Okay.
So he worked there and then he'd work here, you know, mm-hmm. California. So he'd be going back and forth.
So. Yeah. So explain to people how this works now, because you owned rental the first duplex you still owned with your sister, right? So that was purely investment, not your primary residence. So it's an investment and you own it with someone else.
Yeah.
So did you just cash in and pay Uncle Sam his big bucks for capital gains, or
no.
Did you actually attempt to do a 1031 exchange?
We did a 1031 exchange.
Okay.
So, but we had to sell both properties at the same time because she couldn't afford to buy us out. So, on either property. So we sold both properties. So our half of the profit from Lawndale, which we sold for seven something, I think around 700,000. Yes, but it was worth a lot more than
50 to 700, but probably was worth more.
Probably worth more. Mind you, I only owned half of it.
Right.
But still, so 1031'd that. And we just parked it in a safe neighborhood in Orlando. I was nervous about buying in some, what in my mind was a podunk town where hurricanes hit.
Right.
Like, I don't know anything about the East Coast.
Yeah.
So we just found
some. That must have been scary though. So you have this pile of money.
Yeah.
And the exchange rules they say you have to carry the same debt, the same price or higher. I mean, there's all these rules. So you had this, like narrow
window of time,
So how far is
my husband? We don't have a home. We're living in a hotel, and my husband's in Florida shopping for houses.
I do remember that, shopping for houses. But then you're here going, oh geez, what do we do with this bucket of money when I've never seen any of the, like any investor that's going to invest in another state? You were faced with that, like, anxiety, fear, unknown, like, how can I get myself educated fast enough to place this money somewhere, right? So
why we didn't, there's no way you can come up to speed that fast.
Yeah.
So we just found a safe neighborhood. It's a family neighborhood. It's one of those Uber HOAs, planned communities with, you know, the HOA police.
Yeah.
Patrolling.
Measuring how tall your grass is and if the garbage can is off the front lawn in this amount of time after garbage pickup and all that. So,
So Glenn went around with the real estate agent in that one neighborhood and said, I'll take that house and I'll take that house.
Wow. Okay. Well, he's very analytical, right? He's not emotional. So he probably just approached it like, yeah. So how far is Melbourne from Orlando? Like, to give us an idea of how far you were going to live.
About an hour.
Okay. So not too bad, but not that close.
And
why did you not invest close to where you were going to be living?
I just thought, well, Melbourne is like a one industry kind of town. It's space. It's the aerospace industry.
Yeah.
And what does aerospace do?
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
At least that's how it is in LA.
Mm-hmm.
So, I just thought, well, I don't even know good parts of the town. I don't know what rent is. I didn't know what rent was in Orlando either, but it just seemed like a suburb of a big city. That's what I know. So that's what I'm going to change into. I know about being in a suburb in a big city. I don't know anything about living in, I mean, Melbourne isn't the tiniest town, but it's not big either. You know, it's not even 100,000 people.
Okay.
Although it goes town after town after town up the coast the same way, you know, but it is much more than what I was accustomed to.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So that's why we don't know anything about Melbourne. We don't know anything about Orlando, but at least we know what it is. It's what keeps value up in big cities or school districts and, you know, neighborhoods and things like that. So,
mm-hmm.
We just used a realtor and he said, you need to buy an Avalon Park because everybody wants to live here. It's got great schools. It's a planned community and people love that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that's why we went there.
Own duplexes, why didn't you look, or maybe you did, why didn't you look for another duplex? Like, what made you decide to shift to the single family as opposed to the duplex?
I guess because the duplexes for us were always actually single families.
Mm, right.
I mean, it wasn't actually operating as a duplex. It was operating as a single family.
Mm-hmm.
But first of all, duplexes tend to be more, you know, in rental areas,
mm-hmm.
for rental income. And we didn't really know much about that. So we just thought, well, you know, we had enough money from the sale of Lawndale to put a considerable chunk down. And we didn't want to repeat what happened to us in Chicago, where we were just, you know, barely above, very little cash flow for the amount of money we put down. So our mortgage was the rental income. So we want to make sure we had a big enough chunk that we would have a nice, safe amount every month coming in. So,
because I think you were saying in Lawndale, even though the property had gone up in value really fast, the cash flow wasn't that great, right? Because your manager wasn't really raising rents to market rents.
And also because
the expenses, obviously.
My sister had the idea she wanted to pay off the mortgage. So none of that money came to us. She just dumped it into the mortgage every month. So they never, in the beginning, the rent went towards the mortgage of the next house because it was too big of a mortgage for us to swallow, even though we were both sharing. Because
that's interesting. So the cash flow from the Lawndale units were subsidizing.
Subsidizing the mortgage of the second one. But we still had to pay. It was just subsidizing a little bit. Mm-hmm. And then as rents went up, and we kept refinancing because, you know, at that time, the rent rates kept going down. We were able to manage the Torrance house without the rental income, and then they just dumped it right back into the mortgage. So we never.
Okay. So you weren't truly negative in that sense. So
no, but I had no idea.
Okay.
Yeah. I did not do the accounting.
Right. Okay. Okay. Good. Good to know. Okay. And then you were living in the other one. So there was no rental income because the two families were living there. Okay. Got it.
No rental income. And the rental income from Lawndale just went back into Lawndale. So I never saw any of it. And
yeah,
that was that.
And I guess part of
cash flow in Chicago. So
yeah,
we had all of this potential and did nothing with it.
Yeah. So I guess that would be one of my points to people is when you have a partnership, I think, especially with family, maybe with anybody, but family makes it a little more awkward, I think, you know, but with any partnership, you should have a clear understanding of, you know, where's the cash flow going to go? Maybe you want your cash flow out, the other person doesn't, capital contributions. You want to make sure everyone contributes to the repairs and the, because you do have a cash account.
It was a pretty good partnership. We just had a veto rule. Whoever vetoed it, that was it. No, that was it.
Okay.
So there was no argument if one person of the four of us didn't want to do something, and we're all pretty amenable.
Yeah, right.
But we didn't even know about thinking about taking money out of the rental duplex to buy another one, because we eventually wanted to separate anyway. So that would have complicated things.
Mm.
So
yeah, it's the partnership thing too. Yeah. What is your exit with any property? Right? We talk about what is your exit strategy, right?
And we did not really
remember this is an asset, and you say, okay, is this a 5-year plan, 10-year plan? And you don't know how fast market values will go up, or you don't know what you're going to encounter. But to have an idea of, okay, we won't have this together always, or maybe you will. Like, there are families right now that are trying to figure out who's going to get what property because of the new tax law here in California. You really don't want to, change title because you'll get reassessed like that. Right. So if you have an uneven number of properties or uneven number of children, like are you going to give this property to that kid and that property to that kid? Or are you going to, so all of that stuff needs to be considered exit strategy wise too, right?
We didn't really have an exit strategy. We just thought someday in the future, this will be part of our retirement, but we didn't really.
Which is more than a lot of people think. At least you're that far ahead, right?
We're that far ahead. And we're busy raising our boys. And
right.
My boys, she had girls.
Yeah. So, okay. That's funny.
Keep it simple.
Okay, so fast forward to our Florida properties now. So your husband goes, he goes, I'll take that one and I'll take that one.
Sends me pictures. I'm like, all right.
Okay, good.
We close on the same day on the both properties.
Yeah. So what was the price point and what was the rental, gross rental income that you got on those guys?
Okay, so that one.
The pictures start looking better, right? You got more money down. You got no partners.
Yes. Way, 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 way better. So we bought, let's see, where's Ash Mount? We bought Ash Mount. Somewhere's Ash Mount. I can't find Ash Mount, but I think I remember. We bought Ash Mount for $230,000, and we bought Cummings. Those are the street names they were on, for $330,000.
Oh, wow. Big price difference there.
Yeah.
So, and how much rent did you, gross rent, do you get on the one that's 200?
We were pulling in about 700 a month per property.
Oh, net after all expenses, you had 700? Wow, that's pretty good. That's pretty good.
But it was only, I think he said it's like 7.5% ROI.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't terrible.
Not terrible. Mm-hmm.
But, we had a lot of capital wrapped up in them.
Right. The mortgage was small. The mortgages were small. Yeah.
The mortgages were small.
Uh-huh.
So, and then with we took some of the money we got from the sale of the Torrance house we were actually living in.
Mm-hmm. And so that's tax-free money.
Yes. And the bonus he got for moving. And we sold the condo in Chicago.
So you didn't have that drain on you anymore once you sold
it. But we had money that came out of it because we had been paying the mortgage for all those years. So there was equity.
Right.
So the equity. So with all of that, we bought a duplex near us.
Okay.
So where there was a duplex that came into the picture after
we
actually moved here.
Okay.
So, and we paid cash for that.
And how much was that one?
It was $200,000.
Okay, not bad. But close to the beach or inland?
Yeah, pretty close to the beach. Close to Cocoa Beach, but in Merritt Island, which I thought for sure would be really nice because it's so close to the beach. But
yeah,
come to find out the neighborhood wasn't that nice. Like, I like to say there were a lot less teeth on that street than there should have been. Kind of street. If that gives you a clue.
That's funny. Okay. And so, what kind of rent? So was that a long-term rental or?
That was my first Airbnb.
Okay.
I turned that into an Airbnb because it was such a perfect property for it, being so close to the beach. Mm-hmm. And it was super private and it was a very beautiful tropical feel. There was a three-bedroom, two-bath house and a little one-bedroom, one-bath mother-in-law house. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, I can, you know, this is all cash. And also the person who sold it left it half furnished. So I'm like, what am I going to do with all this furniture? You know,
yeah. You just left it in there.
So it was like, well, it's half furnished. Let's do Airbnb.
Okay, cool.
So that's what we did for about 8 months.
Okay.
Great. And of course it was great because there was no mortgage, right?
Right.
But there's very high taxes on Airbnbs.
Right.
So I think the cash flow on that was, I think like $3,000 a month or something like that. It was great.
Right.
$2,000 or something. Mm-hmm. But what we didn't know is that it was illegal.
Oh.
And then we got shut down by the city because the neighbor.
So the city doesn't allow short-term rentals then?
The county does not.
The county doesn't. Okay.
The county doesn't.
Okay.
And they don't enforce the rule unless a neighbor complains.
Oh.
And we
a lot of cities are like that.
Yeah. So we had a very, very nosy and very unhappy neighbor who's unhappy with
everything. Were they making noise or they just didn't like the fact that there were strangers coming in and out?
He literally called me. It's a dead end street with like 8 houses on it. And she literally told me there are people walking up and down the street. There are cars that I do not know. Mind you, my whole entire property is fenced in. So you can't even see the cars. It's just completely private, but there are cars that she did not recognize on
that spooked her.
And she was not, but mind you, she called the cops on her neighbor who was holding a wake for her grandfather. So, I mean, this was not a happy woman. She was having a...
That wake was too loud, too much partying at the wake?
Many people. And somebody was riding a tricycle on the street. It was dangerous.
Oh, yeah.
No, she called on everybody. She called on the neighbor because they were Canadian and she thought they were there illegally. And I mean, I got all the stories from this.
You know, we Canadians can really mess things up and,
we're a little rowdy. Illegally. I mean, they were illegal immigrants.
Yes.
In that house. And they were in their hot tub after 10.
Oh, no. Say it ain't so.
It
so
was
that's
bad.
Troublesome. So on that duplex now, did you sell it or are you going to rent it out? What happened after Airbnb?
No, after I had to move all the furniture out, Hurricane Irma came and completely destroyed it.
Oh, wow. So when was that? End of 2018?
16, actually. Or 17. 17. So we didn't even have it a year when it was completely destroyed.
Yeah. Because I closed escrow on the Pompano Beach units a week before Irma arrived. So yeah, I do remember that now. That was, first week of September in 2017. Okay.
Yeah, so fortunately I didn't have any tenants in there yet because I was transitioning it to being a rental full-time. I thought I was actually trying to find the most annoying, horriblest tenant I could put. I'm like, no English preferred. And if you have a Harley Davidson, you're in.
You're funny.
I was going to go for, but
yeah. So you bought the duplex for cash. Now Irma comes. Did it plow the property down or just?
No, it flooded it.
It flooded it.
Which we didn't have flood insurance.
Right. Well, you didn't have a loan, so you probably didn't think to get flood insurance, right?
Well, I got hurricane insurance.
Okay.
I thought, well, yeah, I want hurricane insurance. And come to find out, hurricane insurance is only good for if it blows the roof off.
Mm.
Not if it rains from the hurricane, only the wind from the hurricane, not the water.
I see. Wow. Okay.
A Californian, who would know that? I mean, a hurricane is a hurricane. It's wind and water event.
Right.
No.
So did you rehab the property? What did you do?
We tried to mitigate it as best as we could. It was mold, of course. We ripped out the walls and the floors, and we were trying to rehab it. And we finally just said, you know what, the property was still like 40 minutes away from our house, 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So like Glenn is working full time, and I've got, two teenagers and a smaller kid. I'm like, we're not flippers.
Mm-hmm.
We can't do this. This is not right. What we do. We don't. And anyways, it's going to flood again.
Mm-hmm. Now you know this can happen, and probably you can't get flood insurance you never had a claim.
I never had a claim, but I know it's going to flood again. I know because somebody blocked up the canal that's the water is supposed to go out into the river into, and it's completely blocked. So I have to sue somebody to open. I'm like, I can't.
So you sold it, I take it.
I sold it for cash, but we were the bank.
Right. So this is where we get to you being the bank.
Yes.
It's amazing. Glenn went to my class and basically did everything that's in the book.
Because we had it, because we owned it in cash.
Right.
I was able to, you can't get a mortgage on a house that's uninhabitable, right? Because you can't get insurance on something that isn't there.
Mm-hmm.
And there are no walls and, so we got a buyer who is a flipper.
Okay.
And so he bought it he put a significant down payment down on it. And we had a 2-year loan.
A balloon note.
6% interest. Mm-hmm. So I think he borrowed $100,000 from us. Mm-hmm. Borrowed. And mm-hmm. he paid us $600 for almost 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then he paid us.
So he paid you $200,000, or what did he pay you for the property?
Like $150,000.
Okay. So you lost $50,000 on the property.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we did make $600 for two years a month.
Sure. Yeah. Sure.
And we made that money while it was an Airbnb.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't terrible.
Mm.
I guess it was terrible, but.
Well, that's a good way to sell, to save something, right? To make something good out of something that's a problem disaster. Because I'm sure your neighbor also would have called the health and safety people. I mean, she would have, made things worse probably, right? Because the property's moldy and icky and whatever.
Oh, yeah. And plus, I knew there was horrible neighbors. So I'm not really that interested in keeping it when it's going to flood again and there's a horrible neighbor. And-
uh-huh.
And potential are bad. Maybe if you have a bad neighbor, it can be really bad.
Really
bad. It can
make
your life miserable.
Yeah, they can make your life hell.
Yeah.
So he probably like fixed up the property, refinanced, and paid you off, right? Mm-hmm. So you're no longer the bank. And what did you do with that money? Where did you invest that money?
So we took that money. What did we do with that? And we sold one of the properties in Orlando.
Oh, okay. For a profit, or what was the price you sold for?
So we sold Cummings. What did we sell it for? We sold. We sold Cummings for $350. I don't think we bought it for $330. We think we bought it for like $285.
Yeah.
And we sold it for like $350.
Okay.
So we 1031'd it, and we took that and some of the cash from
the duplex,
the rest of the cash, whatever it was, like 60,000 or 50,000 or something left.
Mm-hmm.
And we 1031'd it, and we bought a duplex beachside that was, again, a wreck of a house.
Uh-huh.
And
a value buy. We love that.
Yes, a value buy. It was in bad, bad, bad condition. And I bought a Palm Bay house, house in the town next to us. It's not in, it's actually in Melbourne, but we call it the Palm Bay house.
Right.
Because it's next to, interestingly enough, the city next to us has a high school, Palm Bay High, but it's not in Palm Bay, it's in Melbourne.
Yeah, that's funny.
So, I don't know why. So it's a Palm Bay house really close to that high school. And so we bought the two. So we have three units now
from that, right.
The sale of that one and then the other property.
Okay, so on your newest duplex, so you bought that in 2019 then, is that right?
Yeah, so this was actually a few years later.
Right, so this is
a few years later after the hurricane and, you know.
Well, because you made payments for 2 years, right? Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. So so we bought the two properties and we reserved some of the cash from Hortana to help fix up.
This duplex.
The wreck. So
so how's the rec doing now?
The rec took a lot more money than we saved. Uh-huh. up.
Well, you're learning. I mean, this is
it was such a good deal. It was
how much did you pay?
It's literally two blocks from the beach and we paid what did we pay? $280 for it.
Okay.
For and a duplex, two blocks from the beach.
That's amazing.
Yeah, we probably put $60,000 into it.
Okay,
so
you're into it. $340. What do you think the property value is after you fixed it up?
More today, like it's probably worth like $350 to $380, maybe more.
Okay,
property values are just going through the roof here.
Right. Okay.
But somewhere in the mid threes or higher.
Right. Okay.
But
what kind of rent do you get?
So it's a duplex. So one side I have as an annual rental and I'm getting $1,550 a month on that side. And the other side is an Airbnb and I'm pulling in, where's the money? Where's my money man here? Well, I'm renting it for about $100 a night. And I think altogether our cash flow is like around $1,400 a month between the two of them for $1,500 or $1,600 somewhere in there.
Okay.
So that's my cash flow on that one,
okay,
which is
cool.
Good.
That is pretty good.
Awesome.
Yeah,
maybe
yeah.
It's even more, but I can't find the paper with the numbers on it. So
you'll find it. But in the meantime,
it's really good. And so then the other house that we bought, the Palm Bay house, we bought it. And 3 weeks later, it flooded.
The floods. Did you have insurance this time?
I had insurance.
Okay, good.
I had insurance.
Okay, good. But this is a really important lesson. Yeah.
It's important to have insurance. And it flooded from, I think what happened was we had turned the water off because we bought it and the owner moved out and we were going to rent it. But the rental market was so hot. I'm like, I'm not going to turn the utilities on in my name just to have it rented in 4 days.
Right. Because that does complicate things. They got to turn yours off, start the other one. Yeah.
Yeah, turn it off, start the other one or whatever. So, but after a week, it hadn't been rented yet. Well, what is the cash flow? Oh, cash flow is $1,600 a month.
Okay. Well, that makes more sense given your numbers. I'm like, well, where's the rest of the cash flow? Okay. So that's pretty cool. So you invested.
Let's see. Where's Bahama? Where's Bahama going? It is? Okay, so Bahama, that we paid for $160. Again, it was a deal. We paid $100.
Is this the Palm Bay one?
Palm Bay one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you paid $160.
Yes, because it was my real estate agent's father's house. And he was having mental issues and he couldn't show it. So,
wow, what a great thing. So it was $160, but it needed fixing, I guess, right?
Well, not really so much, but 3 weeks after I bought it, it did.
Right. And you had insurance to do the fixing for you. That's great.
I did. Of course, they only pay a percentage. And it was, you know, I had to pay the upfront fees. And then, of course,
right.
You know, they do things. It's still, it was still out of pocket, probably another $20,000 out of it.
Okay. So you're into it $180. And what do you think something like that is worth? I think your realtor is actually going to
probably worth, because it's all brand new now. It's all new kitchens, new floors, new everything. It's probably worth like 250.
Okay. So pretty good. And, 180.
And that one I turned into an Airbnb because it was all brand new and I didn't want to rent it, where renters destroy everything. And Airbnb guests, they come and they eat out.
Right.
And they worry about leaving a mess because you get to rate them. Mm-hmm. Airbnb as a guest, and yep, they're very, very clean. And if they're terrible, they're gone.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In a short amount of time. I haven't had too many terrible Airbnb. I have had a few, but most.
Mm-hmm. And how much do you charge per night for that home?
$100 a night.
$100 a night. And how much, so you have a mortgage on that one, right?
Yeah.
So after all expenses, what's your net on that? Or is that
1300?
Yeah. Like 1300 is your net. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So now, ROI.
Now one thing for full, yeah, for full disclosure though, you do everything for the Airbnbs, right? Like you take the calls, you schedule the thing, you schedule.
I even do the cleaning.
You do the cleaning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we were talking about that, right? So hopefully you're keeping your job and you're making the host happy.
Well, it's very expensive to have that managed. It's like 25% management fee.
Yeah, management fees are hefty.
Very, very high.
And the cleaning fee, I mean, if you have a kind of newer unit, the cleaning's easier than if it's an older unit where the dirt shows easier, the tiles are old school or whatever, right? So,
yeah, I just have vinyl flooring on everything.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to be hiring a maid.
Uh-huh.
So you charge the guests the maid fee. It's just that right, I'm collecting the fee right now.
Right, right. So, you're paying yourself to do it.
Right.
Right. But that's kind of getting old, right?
It's very old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. I was actually planning on hiring a maid, but because of COVID, my snowbirds who were going to be there for 3 months didn't come.
Yeah, me too.
So I was thinking I was going to have both of my Airbnbs were supposed to be rented out for several months with snowbirds. And so I'm like, well, I don't need to hire a maid when I'm not cleaning it, and I'll just clean for the spring. And then the summer I have longer term tenants coming. So I'm like, well, I don't want to hire a maid for 3 months, you know, so I'll just do the cleaning. But then COVID happened and the snowbirds all backed out.
Mm-hmm.
But I it's been completely rented anyways, even through, I mean, I opened the Palm Bay house, I think in March of last year when COVID started.
Right. Right. Cause you had just bought that one and then had to fix it. So
and what took a long time to fix it. And because my insurance was paying rent,
yeah,
I had rental insurance on it too.
Rent loss insurance, gotta love that.
I just told my contractor, just take your sweet time because I don't want to try to rent this at Christmas.
Yeah.
So just tell them you come up against a problem and you had to order something because I don't want to rent it at Thanksgiving, Christmas time, which is when he would have been done. So we kind of like,
yeah,
you know.
Right, to get more coverage of the rent loss insurance.
Yeah.
Got it.
And so I could get a renter when it's a good time to get a renter. So then I opened it right when COVID started in Airbnb.
Right. Right.
So that was kind of.
And how did that go? Like, did you get anyone last year through your Airbnb?
I was completely solidly booked.
That's incredible to me, you know? Yeah.
Well, the first guest, when it was really bad, it was actually good because he was from Trinidad and he couldn't get home.
So right. He was
stuck. My Airbnb. He was stuck. So,
right.
But I didn't charge him. I just charged him very little because,
yeah,
you know, I wasn't going to.
That's a financial dilemma for people that are vacationing, spending more than you would for a regular hotel. You know, you're spending more and then all of a sudden you can't go home. You don't, it's not like you have another budget for a second vacation, right?
No, but you know, he wasn't even there for a vacation. He was there with his sister getting cancer treatments and she passed away.
Oh God.
You know,
Carisa, your stories are just like some amazing.
So he was just stuck there. And as far as I know, he was still stuck in Florida well into August.
Wow.
He could not get back to Trinidad.
Wow. And you had other people coming in, so you really couldn't keep him there, right?
I just kept him there for like 2 months or something. And then he found a cousin who had an empty condo and he moved over there until he could get back. So, but that was fine. It got rented right away and it's been completely full ever since.
That's amazing.
It's totally full.
Because a lot of cities, the Airbnb just shut down. There was nobody, but I guess because Florida was more open as an economy, people were attracted to there, right? To that whole state, I think, but even more so probably Orlando or your area.
I mean, some people were vacationing. I mean, the rules were for that you could only rent to people with essential business. So you just had to ask the people, you're here on essential business, right? Uh-huh. Well, like I don't know if they were or not, but
Your cancer guy, obviously that's essential business. You know, your health is, you know, family member who needs help.
Well, that one, yeah. But other people after him, some
not so much.
Some were on business, some were on family business. I mean, it just was. And then Florida opened up real quick anyways.
Right.
By summertime, we're pretty much.
Yeah, by July, you guys were fully opened up, right? So.
Well, people are flocking here, you know.
Right.
I can't tell you how many people I've had in there who were in there because they were looking for homes to buy.
Really?
So they were staying. Yeah.
Staying in an Airbnb while they're looking to see if they're going to buy there or actually shop for homes.
Or waiting for escrow to close.
So you became temporary housing for people.
Yeah. I've had a lot
people
of that.
Buying homes. Yeah. Wow. That's interesting. Yeah. Cause, a lot of people, couldn't do the Airbnb. Right. So,
Well, you know, they're not, it's still not allowed.
Right.
But.
Right.
They also collect taxes on it.
Right.
Like the city,
so if they cut off that income stream, then they hurt their, and you guys don't have state tax there, right? There's no state tax in Florida.
Mm-mm, no income.
That's a huge savings for you guys, right?
It was huge. Oh, so now what we're doing is we're selling, we're in the process of selling the other Orlando property.
Okay. What's your vision for the next?
I have an offer on a duplex in Cocoa Beach.
Okay.
Again, one half Airbnb, the other half rental, and I will have enough left over to buy another something, which I don't know what.
That is awesome. Congratulations. And why do you do, I think I know the answer, but I like for people to hear, why do you do a long-term person on one side of the duplex and short-term on the other side? Why not both short-term and make lots of money? You can double your income and all that stuff.
Well, the first duplex, we did that because, well, first of all, it was right in the middle of COVID. I wasn't sure if I would be booked.
Okay.
And also we didn't fix up that side, one side, as much as the other. So I didn't want to spend money to fix up the other side to what I would need it to be for Airbnb. It would have been another
not thing. Knowing if you were going to get the income stream, right?
Right. And it's just a cash flow issue. I didn't have another $30,000, especially now I'm dealing with a flooded house.
Right. Okay.
I'll just get a tenant in there. And then also it's steady income every month, you know,
right.
And also it's just somebody to, you know, look after the property. You know, somebody who cares about the property,
mm-hmm.
you know, so it's kind of nice to have that, you know, eyes on the property.
Yeah. I was thinking you have a built-in spy, right? And a witness. So if you have another crazy neighbor saying there's parties every day, you can say, well, gee, my tenant lives there full time. And he says there's, you know, so you've got like a witness for any kind of shenanigans like that, right? False accusations.
The duplex in Cocoa Beach, there's a long time tenant in one of the units. I don't know if I'm going to get it. We just have an offer on it.
Right.
And she's paying $2,000 a month, which is really high.
Huh.
And, You know, for Cocoa Beach. Cocoa Beach is like the premier spot. It's like Manhattan Beach of Florida coast. It's only 2,000 a month. I know, it's so funny.
It's funny. So what's your price point on that one? And what do you think you could, what is the real market rent on these units, do you think?
I think she's at market value.
Okay.
And the other side, it costs money to turn things into Airbnbs because it can't just be, I mean, it can be, but you're not going to make much money with just, you know, it's got to look good, right?
It has to have staging, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that one, I offered $560 for it. Mm-hmm. And this one is like, literally, you can see the beach from the front porch. I mean, it's so close. It's not on the beach, but you can't really get much closer without being on the beach.
Yeah, so the pictures will be good. So that's important,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and it's Cocoa Beach, which is, like I said, it's like the Manhattan Beach of our area.
Right.
High end. So that one, we think we're going to be running about a $2,000 a month positive cash flow.
Mm-hmm. Right, because you're putting a big down payment on that one from the proceeds from the other.
We'll save some of the proceeds and buy something else too, which I hope to get at least $500 a month for. So I'm hoping to be like $2,500. So I went from $700 a month from this little house in Orlando to, I hope to be $2,500.
Right.
So I'm trying to grow our cash flow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this, I love that. And hopefully people are not bored, but I think it's fascinating to hear the steps that you go through to build this. And, mm-hmm. and really even if we call it 5 years, you know, from the time he's scouting for a house or the exchange, he probably was more focused on the exchange than finding a house to live in is actually easier than finding an exchange up leg. Right. So,
For us, we just randomly picked two houses.
That's the good neighborhood. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah. So in the space of 5 years, you've been through a lot, but built, you know, and I think it takes guts. What I admire is that you cut your losses, move forward. You know, something happens, you examine it, you decide what you and you move forward, right? There's no,
yeah, you have
like
to
some people would have held on to that duplex that was flooded out and, you know, had the not so good neighborhood. Some people would have just hung on and insisted on making it work. Do you know what I mean? Because losing money is never a fun thing.
Flexibility is key, I think, because if it's not working, why would you want to keep it not working?
Yeah. Well, because some people insist on making it work, you know, that if they just do this little, you know, so cutting your losses is a big lesson, I think, and to learn it that quickly in your investing career, that's pretty admirable. So we're across the country, we're having problems finding contractors. So how is it in South Florida with the contracting community? Can you find people to fix properties, or is it pretty tight?
I hear it's very tight.
Mm-hmm.
I hear it's very, very tight. That said, the contractor I worked with on the first duplex, he literally finished it. And 2 weeks later, I said, I have a flood. So, you know, he considers himself to be my contractor.
Yeah, so right. Because he's been fully employed by you for
for 6 months. Exactly. So, but also my tenant in Orlando is a contractor.
Oh, yes, that's right.
So if push comes to shove, I could probably get, if I had a big enough project, I probably could get him. But there's a lot of people, like one of the people I had in my Airbnb over COVID, he was moving from New York. He just had it with New York, and he works in construction. So there's a lot of people moving here
with skills
in construction and so forth and so on.
That's awesome.
Because they see the opportunity here. So I don't know if that's across the board. That was just my own, one experience.
Right.
But, I don't know how hard it is. It's what's hard to do is find a contractor who will show up when they say they're going to show up. and do what they're going to do when they say they're going to do what they're going to do. And my contractor may not be the cheapest, but he shows up and he does what he says he's going to do and he does a good job. So I would probably call on him again. I'm hoping not to have to do that. I'm hoping what the duplex I put an offer on, it has some cosmetic stuff. So I wouldn't probably hire.
On the Airbnb side, you at least need nice appliances, nice countertops. Even if
it's already done. That stuff's already done.
Okay, got it.
But what it needs is furniture, it needs a coat of paint, and it needs landscaping.
Mm.
So I'm not going to get a contractor for that. I'll probably just find somebody,
you know,
day laborer guy or something. But,
and how much per night do you think you're going to get on that Cocoa Beach the Airbnb side?
Probably 140.
140. Wow, that's so cheap for a nice area. That's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Right on the beach, 140, 150, something like that. Somewhere, you know, I like to be a little under market, so I'm full.
Right. And how often do you check the pricing of the units? Do you check that at the beginning of the season? And do you have like a routine where you say, let me just check my pricing? Because I think because so many places are going to be restricting Airbnb short-term rentals, that's going to, for those who want to pay to play there, you know, the prices will probably go up. So do you check your levels or?
I do.
Competitive?
I just, so often when I'm cleaning the rental and I'm waiting for laundry to be done.
Right. You're checking things. Yeah.
I'm just checking.
Don't waste your time, right?
Competitive and
Do you post it only on Airbnb or do you have other sites you use or what's your strategy in marketing the property?
Okay, so when I had my first Airbnb, I was on VRBO and Airbnb, but it's convoluted with the scheduling and I was always nervous about the calendar.
Yeah, the fear of double booking yourself.
Yeah, and they're supposed to, you know, talk to each other and whatever. The calendars are supposed to update with each other's bookings. But you know how those things are. There's always going to be an issue because things happen.
Yeah.
So one time my maid didn't go because it didn't show up on the calendar and somebody came and it was dirty. I had a maid for that one because it was pretty far away.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I didn't want to do that again.
Yeah.
So this time I said, I'm just going to go with Airbnb. And if it stays booked, I won't go on VRBO. But if it comes to the point that I'm not getting it booked, then I would consider other places. But just because of the calendar issues, it just complicates things unnecessarily.
Mm.
If you can stay booked on one site versus another, you know, and I don't know if one is better than the other. I just pick
that's the one you're with, right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And do you have backups for your cleaning people and your, you don't have cleaning people anymore.
Are
you going to have backups? Like you're saying, you're going to hire a cleaning person now. Are you going to have more than one just to make sure?
I'm going to hire a company that has several employees.
Okay, got it.
They don't have an issue.
And they have insurance and all that stuff.
Yeah. I'm going to hire somebody that's got some employees, at least a few, because I'm going to have three, maybe, you know, four, depending on the other ones. So it's just too much
for
one person.
For you to be running around doing all this. And
yeah.
Of course, people arrive at the same time, right? early so I can make sure.
I have hired other people. Like if that happened, like I had two in the same day, I'd hire somebody. I have a friend.
Okay.
Who just, you know, if she's available, she pocket change for her for the day. It's good money. It's, you know, 3 hours and it's $100, you know,
Yeah, sure. It's not bad.
It's not bad.
Especially since you have no state tax there. Not that I'm rubbing it in or anything.
Mind you, the tax on the Airbnb is like 12.5%.
Ours is, well, the desert down here is 12. Most cities are 12. Santa Monica's 14, you know. Yeah, sure you miss it.
If I would come back to California and I'm like, no.
You're not coming back? Wow, that's drastic.
Never. I mean, I'll visit.
Right.
Never. I would
not
never.
Moving your family back or yourself and your husband back. Right. 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 Well, this has been very enlightening. I mean, I could ask you lots more questions, but our time is kind of up.
Well, out of the floods.
I know.
And murders.
Yeah. Murders and floods and, you know, cancer patients. And my gosh, man, this.
Yeah, life happens.
Really a great story. But thanks for sharing like the details, because I think it helps people get a picture of how you get yourself out of some very scary situations. And as an investor, when you cut your losses and, you know, all those things that we learn as investors, right? So
I've cut a few losses, you know, I've made a lot of mistakes, more mistakes than good choices, actually. But now I feel like I'm making a lot better choices, or and I want to grow my portfolio to I'd like it to be double what I'm making now, or triple. Next 5 years is my goal. So now I have like a more focused goal and focused on the real estate. Now that my boys are, I have a 14-year-old, but the other two are going off to college. Oh, that's the other thing I'm doing. I'm buying a condo in Orlando.
Okay.
This summer.
For them to manage or to live in while they're at school, or?
To live in while they're at school. And then they're going to share a room and we're going to rent the other side.
Okay.
So we'll have like a mortgage of like $400.
Right.
But
and how much do you think the second bedroom for college students? What will you get for that? Do you think
$700?
So that's pretty good. Plus, they're going to learn to manage, you know, to manage a household basically. So, which is really important that they learn how this works so that they can take over. Do you know how many of my clients that own real estate like entire portfolios? And their kids have no idea how it works, what they need to do, how to talk to a property manager, what the issues are that come. No idea, right? And that's kind of dangerous because they'll get taken advantage of in one way or another because they'll have to hire people for all that, right? So, so that's amazing, amazing that they're going to learn that at a young age. And they can then buy property, right? I hope they buy property like as soon as they graduate, or as soon as they have
my oldest said, I have to learn how to do this because I'm going to inherit all this stuff. I have to know what to do with it.
God. At least he realizes, right?
Yeah, he goes, someday this will be mine. I guess I better figure this out.
Yeah, good. That's awesome. That's awesome, Carisa. Yeah,
they come with me to clean the apartments, and they were my gardener for a while. We have gardeners now, but you know, they have to help. It's a they're benefiting from the money I'm making, so they have to help in the work of it.
That's right. Right.
So
that's awesome. And then you can 1099 them for doing work, and they could start an IRA for themselves.
They both already have an IRA.
Awesome.
They both have one, and one is actively managing his money in it.
Awesome. That's awesome.
So, yeah, it's great. It's really great. So, but actually they're going to buy the condo.
Oh, they're going to buy the condo?
Because as you know, investment
to get the owner occupied,
and it'll build their credit,
right?
So,
in the class, I call that kiddie condo, but it's really, you know, you can do that with FHA or Fannie Mae. Is have kids with no jobs be owner occupants to get the best rate with the parents as co-signers, much better than buying it as a rental.
Right. So it's been
get the juice at the end. See, the people who hung on are getting the juice.
Yeah, if you have kids going to college, that's the way to go, because it's like expensive. The dorms or renting a room in Orlando is between $600 and $900 for one kid.
Month.
Got two going.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Wow. Yeah. Good for you.
I'm not doing that.
That's awesome. The
mortgage is way cheaper.
Yeah. So, well, anyway. Then you get the tax benefits and everything. And once they're done with school, that's a rental property that's in the portfolio now, right?
Exactly.
For very good leverage, very good interest rates. Even still today, the rates are great. So,
yeah.
Well, congratulations. That is awesome, my dear. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And thriving.
It was really learning a lot from you in that that class, and then the cash flow game. And we bought cash flow for Christmas. We played it with the kids this year. So
awesome! Oh my God, you should have sent me a picture of that. That would have been awesome.
Well, I should have.
I'm glad that my brainwashing techniques are working.
Yeah, and I won. Just saying.
Woo-hoo! Bye. Well, good. Congratulations on your win.
Oh, thank you.
Great. Well, great. Well, yeah, thank you so much, Carisa, for being so generous with your time and your honesty and being so transparent. I really appreciate it. And I'm sure everyone learned from it. And it's just awesome. So, well, thanks, Carisa. Have a great evening. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for Women in Investing. And we'll see you soon on our next episode. Bye-bye now.
Bye.
This has been another episode of My Cashflow Academy's Investor's Corner with your host, Athena Paquette-Cornier. We wish you all the success you deserve as you use what you've learned here out in the real world. Check out the blog post for this episode, along with many more helpful resources at mycashflowacademy.com.